Are you ready for the word of the Lord? Yes. World Overcomers Church, soon to be Encounter Church, give a big God bless you to everyone watching today. Yes. Wherever you are, whoever you are, welcome. I have a word from heaven fresh that God gave me last night. Here's the message. There is a miracle in your mouth. I'll say it again. There is a miracle in your mouth. And with that, you can say right under it, speak the word only. Somebody shout, speak the word only. Come on, let me hear you shout it. Tell your neighbor, say, literally say, there's a miracle in my mouth. Tell your other neighbor, say, speak the word only. Just last night, God gave me this fresh manna, revelation. Now, let's start this morning in the book of Matthew. I'll give you a moment to find it. It's the first book in the New Testament, Matthew, the 8th chapter. And we're looking at, right now, a story that many of you heard before, but now we're going to dissect it just a bit in a short amount of time. Somebody once again say, there's a miracle in my mouth. Absolutely. Speak the word only. Now in Matthew chapter 8, those of you watching at home, wherever you are, Matthew chapter 8, verse number 5, if you have access to a Bible, if not, you can just listen. In Matthew chapter 8 is where we begin. Church, are you ready? Yes. Verse number 5. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him. Not just asking, begging if you will. Pleading with Jesus. Aren't you glad today that he's your God and that you can call upon his name? Pleading with him, verse 6, saying, Lord, he recognized him as Lord. My servant, that is a centurion servant, is lying at home. Now catch this. He's paralyzed. Not only is he paralyzed, but tormented. But if you look back, he's not just tormented, he's dreadfully tormented. Now, I in my lifetime have found people who were paralyzed. How many know somebody who's been paralyzed? Anybody? I have some friends, and particularly through sports, that have become paralyzed. So I've seen paralyzed men. I've seen paralyzed women. Joni Erickson Tada, the young lady in the wheelchair, she writes all the books for Wheaton Bible College and throughout the world now. I've met and I've seen paralyzed people. I've also seen people that have been tormented. Now, I'm not talking about just being going through a hard time or struggling. I've met tormented people. I've prayed deliverance over tormented people. How many have ever known somebody that's been tormented, or even yourself? But frankly, in almost 58 years, come this June 27th, ooh, that just slipped out of my mouth. I don't know why I said June 27th. It just happened. It just came out. But in my almost 58 years of life, honestly, and my roots are deep. I'm third generation Christian, born again. But I've never once in my life met anybody, maybe you have, that was at home, number one, paralyzed, number two, dreadfully, number three, tormented, number four. All my 58 years, I've never met anybody in my life, and I'm sure they're out there, that fits into this qualification. So imagine now, here's a man, tormented, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented, so you have a better understanding of where we're going. So this centurion, by the way, he's like a, we'll call him a sergeant in the army. And this sergeant in an army has one of his soldiers, let's just call him a private. This private is very ill. That's who the centurion captain or sergeant, whatever you want to call him, captain, sergeant. He said, Lord, my servant, my private, one of my soldiers is lying at home, paralyzed and dreadfully tormented. Verse 7. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. Let's stop right there. I will come and heal him. Now let's be very blunt. Can we all be very blunt? If I personally met Jesus physically, of course I've met him spiritually. We all have. But if I personally met Jesus and I just told him about this situation and Jesus said to me, sure, give me the address. I'll put it in my GPS and I'll be right over. I don't think there's a one of us here that would say, oh no, Lord, it's okay. How many would love for a celebrity, one of your favorite, to visit your house? And then you tell your friends about it. And all your friends come. Well, here's not just a celebrity. Here's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Not even receiving an invitation. Because the leader here of the Syrian army did not invite him to his house. Now, why would he not? I have people all the time. It goes with my territory. And I'm complimented by that. Can you come to my house? Would you have dinner with me? Would you have lunch with me? Would you play basketball with me? Would you? And these are compliments, and thank you. But here's a man that did not ask Jesus, would you come over my house for unleavened bread and matzo ball soup and a side of manischewitz? He didn't say, can you come to my house for spaghetti and meatballs or taquitos or rice or beans or chitlins and ribs? He simply said, Jesus, Lord, there's so much to catch here, guys. I have one of my soldiers who's ill. He didn't say, Jesus, come to my house and come visit him. The problem with many Christians today is they're more interested in seeing how a man can meet their demands. I don't mean you necessarily, I'm just speaking out loud. But many Christians today, and this is a fact, are more interested to see if a man's presence will enter their home than they are about the Lord paying a visit without making a visit. Some people are more concerned. Some people rate a pastor. Somebody shout, not in this house, because it's not in God's word. Some people rate a pastor. Did he visit me when I was sick? Critical check. We'll call this the critical checklist. Being critical. The critical spirit check. Somebody say the critical spirit checklist. So I'm telling you why 1,800 pastors quit every month. And 4,500 churches close every year. This is the critical pastor checklist. Rather than blessing the feet of those that preach good news. Okay? Somebody shout, not in this house. But we're going to call it the critical pastor checklist. I was sick. Did she not know? My son was sick. Nobody came to visit me. Nobody sent me a card. Nobody followed. Flesh, let me tell you what's, can I tell you something that has more authority than a devil? Can I tell you something that has more authority than the devil? Remember, this man was severely tormented. Can I tell you something, Pastor Joe, that has done more damage than a demon? Flesh. Nowhere in the Bible does it say crucify demons every day. It says crucify flesh every day. Now we're going somewhere with this. The critical checklist can go on, but I think I've shared enough. Recently, I went out and I purchased 2 boats. I'm just giving you a second to see what spirit is going to rise up next, to see if maybe just one of you have a critical spirit. So we'll just let the atmosphere sink in a little bit, and let me see your faces to see. And let me tell you something. As a prophetic voice, I look beyond faces. I look into hearts. You can disguise on Halloween, but you cannot disguise in the house of the Lord. So I went out. You know, we're debt-free now, so I took the church's money, or not the church's money. It's never been the church's money. I took God's money after 21 years, and I went out and I bought me 2 big boats, yachts. I love them. You know what they say about boats? Can't wait to sell, can't wait to buy them, can't wait to sell them. If you have a boat, God bless you. Jesus was all about boats. He had a boat ministry. In fact, one time he was so fed up with people that he went out to the Sea of Galilee on a boat. He could have walked on water, so don't criticize boats. So anyway, I thought I would take God's money and buy a couple of boats. So I bought one for me and I bought one for Pastor Derek. Aren't you happy for him? And I named my boat Visitation. And I named Pastor Derek's boat Visitation 2. So my boat is Visitation, your boat is what?
Visitation
2. Visitation 2. So somebody calls the church and they said, I'm in need. Can I talk to the pastor? And the receptionist said, I'm sorry. He's on visitation. They said, okay, can I speak to the assistant pastor? She said, I'm sorry. He's on visitation too. And those of you that almost got offended, deal with it. Now watch here, guys. Watch this very carefully. Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurions could have easily said, wow! Now, I used to be in the sports field. I used to be an agent. Some of you know I used to be an agent. And I've had celebrities at my home. I've had big-time celebrities come visit my house. We'd fellowship together, or we'd do business together. Or I would bring them to other people's homes for private autograph sessions. When I say other people, I'm talking about baseball card shops, people like that in business. I was, well, with many celebrities and superstars, and Sister Vella will tell you, back in the years ago, we had Sammy Sosa, we had Horace Grant from the Bulls, we had them all. They were my clients. They were my clients. Our church alone filled up half the Charlestown Mall. Yeah, so these were my clients. So many times some of these clients would come to my house and we'd sign contracts together or we'd exchange money together. I'd pay them. I'd get paid. And I would tell some of my friends, hey, you know what? So-and-so's coming to my house. No. You're joking. I remember telling my dad, one of my dad's favorite baseball players was a man named Yogi Berra. Most of you know, I'm not talking about Yogi Bear, Yogi Berra. I called up my dad one day. I said, Dad, this is when I lived in Florida. I said, Dad, I don't know what you're doing this afternoon, Dad, but if you're free, would you like to hang out with me and Yogi Berra? Now, you know, that's today's version of the most celebrities of celebrities, back in the day, that is. And my dad said, Jimmy, you're kidding me. Jimmy, you're kidding me. I said, no, Daddy, I'm serious. Hey, Jimmy, if you, I'll never forget, Jimmy, if you're lying to me, if you're pulling my leg, I'm going to break your legs. Now, back in the day, you couldn't say that. If you just say that today, back in the day, our parents would break our legs. God forbid you say that today, just saying it, you'll wind up in. So I called my dad, I said, no, Dad. He said, Jim, I'm bringing Tom with me. That's Tom McDonald, his buddy from Brooklyn, his Irish friend from Brooklyn. I'm bringing Joe McCarroll, his Italian friend from the Bronx. And sure enough, here we were all together with Yogi Berra hanging out in Tampa. And my dad was like, wow. Imagine LeBron James coming to your house. Imagine a celebrity. Imagine Kim Kardashian. No. I don't think she'd fit through the door. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's okay. Lord, my servant is home and he's paralyzed. This ain't funny. He's dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. I'll come. This soldier, this captain, sergeant could have said, Lord, yeah, here's my address. The Lord's saying, I don't need your address. I'm the beginning, I'm the end. I know all things. I'm the first, the last, the Alpha, Omega. You need to tell me where he lives? I created him. My daddy. But this man could have just seized the moment where the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords was going to come to his house. But the amazing thing is, the furthest thing from the centurion's mind was getting Jesus to his house. Many times we're more concerned about our house than God's house. Many times we prepare more for our house than for God's house. When God says, if you reverse it, if you take care of my house, I'll take care of your house. The American way is I take care of my house, and then I take care of God's house. We have it reversed. The American system doesn't work. I'm proud to be an American, but I'm glad I don't do it the way the Americans do it. I'm glad I don't do it the way the black folk do it, or the way the Indian folk do it, or the white folk do it, or the Hispanic folk, or Filipino people. I'm glad that I've chose to do it God's way. And I'm certainly glad I don't do it the Italian way. Bada bing, bada bang. Forget about it. Lord, verse 6. My servant is laying. He's laying. He can't move. He's dreadfully tormented. He's paralyzed. Jesus said, come. I will come and I will heal him. We'd all love to have Jesus at our house. We'd all love to seize the moment. But watch verse 8. This is for somebody right now. Look at verse 8. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof. Stop right there. I'm not worthy. We don't have to admit it publicly, but if you want, you can give yourself a private amen. The American culture has taught us that we are worthy. The American culture has taught us that instead of ministry, we ought to have marketing. The American church taught us how to build a church around a personality. That's why every superstar church, where the pastor falls, the church goes with it. Because it's built on a person. It's built on a personality. And here, we have a man that says, and he's a leader. People salute him. I'm not worthy. What humility. Talk about making no demands on God. Of course, you better come to my house. You visited my brother, but you didn't visit my sister. That is all manipulation, in which Galatians 6 saints calls witchcraft. We're talking about there's a miracle in your mouth. We'll get to it. Speak the word only. Centurion said, his response was, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. Watch this. But speak only a word, or only speak a word, and my servant will be well. My servant will be healed. Look at me, please. I am here today as an authoritative figure over you, Hebrews 13:8, but under God, telling you that you have the capability of speaking a word and watching it come to pass. You have the ability, if you can rip up or burn up any checklist of what you expect, because can I tell you something? If we want to live by the checklist, I've got mines. Would you like to know my checklist toward you? The only difference is mine is based on the word. Yours is based on the flesh. Tell your neighbor, say, he's just talking to the atmosphere. Go ahead, tell him. Tell your other neighbor, say, I know that's not me. But speak a word only, and my servant will be well. He'll be healed. This man, deep down inside, he would have loved to have Jesus at his house. He would have loved to entertain him. I'm sure he had a nice home. He was a leader. He would have jumped on the opportunity to invite his cousins and his friends. But he said, Lord, just speak the word. Now notice, he did not say think the word, Mark. He did not say dream. He said speak. Here is a centurion, which were not very popular. They were looked down upon. And he said, Lord, speak the word. Folks, for all of us, for all the churches in America and around the world, we need to be more concerned about speaking God's word and speaking less about others in a negative way, building people up, especially those that feed us, not him or her, them, those, plural, and spending more time focusing on what God can do than what man can do. He said, speak the word only, and I know that my servant will be healed. Now, he says this to Jesus. People were begging Jesus, come here, I need this, I need that. Again, I cannot reiterate enough. Here's a man who's dreadfully tormented and he's fully paralyzed. He's at home. He cannot be taken out of the house. Run, Jesus, run. Come here now, Jesus, come here now. Sometimes we can get so caught up in a personality and lose sight of the person. Let it rest. Now look at this next verse. This is the Bible. This is the New Covenant. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. I explained that earlier. And I say, what's the S word? Say. I speak, just like you speak, Jesus. I say to this one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does that. Now look at me, please. This is a centurion soldier telling his troops what to do. I say, you do this, and you do it. You do that, and you do it. It was biblical, it was authentic, it was legal in the eyes of God. Jesus didn't stop and say, hold on, before we get to your servant, son, let me rebuke you. What gives you the right to tell people what to do? That was not the case. Just think for a moment, and again, you can smile and you have pretty teeth, and you have pretty hair and pretty makeup and nice hairstyles. But imagine for a moment, don't imagine, it happens. It's happened to me throughout my life, and it will continue. Imagine me standing up here. Here's a soldier in a natural army fighting a natural war. How many believe, let's keep me out of the picture because I don't want you to think that I'm looking for praise. How many think this morning that if we can honor natural authority, whether in the service, the army, whatever branch of service, and we salute them even when they get in our face and say, you do this, you do that. How many believe this morning, if it's true in the Bible and Jesus endorsed it, how did he endorse it? Because he did not condemn it. He went along with it. How many believe all the more in the spiritual, whoever the authority is, we need to honor them and listen to what they say. But here's a man, he needs a miracle. Now look at me all with your pretty faces, please, and give me a big smile. Give me a Ray Charles smile so that you can keep your eyes closed so you'll never know I'm looking at you, okay? Just go like this, guy. Just go like this. Are you doing it? I'm not watching. I'm going to open my eyes. If I don't see you doing it, I'm going to come down there. Okay, you can open. All right? Don't ever pretend that this does not apply to you or not applicable. How many times in our hearts and minds have we forfeited our miracle and our blessing because we were more concerned about what the man is going to do or what the woman's going to do? Are they going to meet my demands, my critical list, my expectations versus what God can do? I wonder, well, I don't wonder, if I spoke the way he spoke, how many would get offended this morning? Now look, he says, I speak to this one individually, to another individually. Imagine this morning if I called one of you out, because we're supposed to be the army of God. The army of God comes together on Sunday morning. Not the audience, but the army. Imagine if I called you out on something. Come on, come on, Ray Charles, no, nobody's seeing. But God's doing something. Imagine if I called somebody out this morning and told you the gospel truth. Tuesday night, boys, get ready. I'm going to speak the gospel truth. God gave me a word on enablers. Enablers. If we're not careful, we become enablers and we enable others. If you're not careful, if I'm not careful, the well things that we mean for our children, if we're not careful, we can make them enablers. That's another story. Church members, family, job, enablers. Enablers never are fruitful and they never multiply. And many times we, the parents, we, the pastors, are responsible for causing our children, because we love them so much, where actually it's backfired because now they're dependent on every single thing. And thus, they're not interested in being fruitful and multiplying. They're interested in being an enabler to see what they can get. It doesn't mean that they're bad kids. It means that perhaps, maybe, including myself, partially, maybe we didn't teach our children correctly. And everyone said, well, here's a guy who's not an enabler. He was not codependent. He spoke the word. But imagine today, if I said something today that you didn't like to hear. Go here, go. Some of you would call me a slave driver. Some of you would call me a dictator. I've been called that before. Some of you would call me a controller. That's one of my most popular names. But imagine a natural army and the man. Now notice here. It says that he was paralyzed, dreadfully tormented, but it doesn't say that he was not a believer. So imagine a sergeant or a captain being so interested in somebody's physical life, thus that sergeant, captain, would speak in a way, what? Not to embarrass or humiliate or to hurt, but to get those troops in line. And if this man was a natural captain, and if his soldier was a natural private, how much all the more should we hear, listen with the spirit of humility and a teachable heart to those that have not only your back physically, but are looking out for your eternity. Now, folks, I'm not trying to build me. I'm trying to build you. Got it. Now, watch this. We're in verse number 9. He comes and he goes, do this and do that. Now, Jesus is making a point in verse number 9, 10. When Jesus heard it, heard what? Something was said. When Jesus heard that this man said, no, you don't need to come to my house. You don't need to. He said, Jesus heard it. He marveled, and he said to those who followed, assuredly I say, what's the S word? I say to you, in particularly you, maybe not you, but you, maybe not you, but you. That's why you don't get your miracle, but you do. That's why you don't progress in life, but you do. Maybe that's why you don't have favor, but you do. Are you catching this? Jesus said, never! In all of Israel, most assuredly, I say to you, I have never found such great faith. Never have I found great faith. And faith is the victory. Faith will raise the dead. Faith will bring revival to America. Faith will heal the sick. Faith will turn your life around. But we have to take the focus off of our expectations, because they're false, they're deceiving, they're deceptive, and they're filled with lies. That's what the flesh does. That's why people who leave a family or a church or a job, they will never, ever be satisfied until they deal with that darn root in their own life. I have not found such great faith in all of Israel. Now, let's go back here, guys. Let's read this real quick, because I want this to get really into your spirit. Go back to verse 5, please. Just to let it penetrate. Let it penetrate. Now, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him. Pleading. Say pleading. Pleading. Next verse. Saying. What did he do? Saying. Did he think or did he say? Saying. Did he speak? Did he declare and decree a thing with his mouth? Yes. Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. Next verse. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. Next verse. Centurion answered, saying, Lord, Lord, no, 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 no. I am a man. I am not worthy that you should come under my roof. But speak a word only, and my servant will be healed. In other words, busy people understand the life of busy people. Do you hear me? Somebody sends you a text and they don't respond for a few hours and you get offended. You know why you get offended? Because you don't understand that that person does not live according to your busy or your boring schedule. I'm not saying you per se. You understand what I'm saying? So you expect everybody to be where you want them to be. You expect everybody to react the way you want them to react according to the way your lifestyle is. My old friend, Dr. Roy Harthorn, Pastor Benny Hinn's father-in-law, used to have a sign in his office. It said, if you don't have anything to do, don't do it here. But in this verse, listen, teach us to number our days. Do we need more clarity than that? Be a good steward with your time. Faith, it's required of us, right? So here is this man saying, Lord, I'm not putting myself on your level, but I understand authority. Did you hear what I just said? I understand what? Authority. Look at me, please. When you understand authority, you'll understand the reality of what's waiting for you. He said, Lord, I'm a busy man. I could only imagine how busy you are. That's why when business people get together, they have business conventions. Wealthy people associate with wealthy people. Iron sharpens iron. We're not putting anybody down. What I'm saying is there is a mentality of people. There are those that feel that you owe me, and there are those that feel I cannot give enough. And this sergeant, this leader, and I know I'm repeating this purposely, he said, Lord, I understand the value of time. I understand the value, how busy you are. I understand, Lord, that I'm not the only apple on the vine or the only grape on the vine, the only apple on the tree. Now, folks, please do not hear what I'm not saying because I'm ministering to a variation of people in this room today. That does not mean that we cannot spend any time with people or individuals. I'm not saying that. Stay with the subject, okay? He says, Lord, I understand busyness. I understand authority. I know what it's like to be in a position where I have to tell somebody, sit down. God forbid you say that today. And you scatter the whole church. That's why I say don't do it the American way. Do it God's way. I love America, but do it God's way. This man understood authority. When we understand authority, now look, go back to the next verse. 9. For I am also a man under authority. In other words, Lord, I understand. You're busy having soldiers under me. And let me tell you something else, what I found out in humanity, in 41 years of ministry. So don't just take this. I'm just speaking to everyone that I've ever ministered to in my life and those I haven't ministered to. But some people have unrealistic expectations. And the more they look for man to do what they expect man to do, the more they'll be disappointed. The more they'll find gossip. The more they'll hurt people will hurt people. Confused people will confuse people. Look to heaven and say, not me, God. Go ahead, I dare you. I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this one, go, and he goes to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this and do that. Verse 10. When Jesus heard it, he was marveled. He was what? Marveled. Now, we could think of many words for marveled, but he was marveled. He was overwhelmed. And he said, most assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith in Israel. We're talking about there's a miracle in your mouth. Speak the word only. The way God allows us to use our faith is when we focus and put our faith in God. Love each other, but only God can perform your miracle. Pray for each other. Be there for each other. Love each other, but only faith in God. I want you to say out loud, faith in God. Come on, even louder. Now drop down to verse number 13. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way. As you have what? Believed. As you have believed, so let it be done to you. Watch this. And his servant was healed. Somebody get ready to shout. His servant was healed that very hour. Jesus never even went to his house. And so gets offended because he didn't call me. So-and-so gets angry because she didn't show up or send me another postcard. See, that's becoming an enabler. Sometimes you can reach out to somebody too much. This is why the prodigal son's father had to make the most critical decision of his life. He had to let his son go, or else he would have continued to raise a spoiled brat. And in his case, he showed extra affection to him because he knew he had another son and he already lost one. And many times it's mercy that we want to do things in. And mercy's great, but the Bible says it's by wisdom we build our house. I want to leave a legacy to you and to my children. Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. And the inheritance I want to leave you is to do it God's way. Teach your children how to fish. Teach your children how to trust in God. Yeah, but you don't understand. They put this peer pressure on you. Well, my friends, you know, their parents pay for this. You could just say, you know what? I'm not your friend's mom. I'm not your friend's dad. I'm me. And maybe silver and gold I may not have like they have, but such as I do have, in the name of the Lord, take it. Take it. And he was healed that very hour. Jesus never even went to his house because this leader understood authority. I'm just going to say this, and I'm just going to say, because the preparation of the heart belongs to a man, the answer of the lip is of the Lord. And I'm fine. I'm good. I'm grooved to it. I feel good. I ain't got no gripes or anything. I'm good. And if I ever do have a gripe, it's in the spirit. I'm good. But I'm just going to tell you, because you're kids, and don't be condemned. Fathers and mothers don't condemn their kids. They correct their kids. I'm not here to condemn you. I'm here to correct you. But the truth is, when service is over today, it should not be Pastor Joni and I back there greeting you. It should be you coming running to us, greeting us. Don't cut off the hand that feeds you. No, listen, we're good. We love you. I'm not talking about us receiving a personal greeting. I'm looking for you to see above and beyond into your future so that you can have God's best always. With or without me. With or without me. There have been people in my life in the past. Some here in this room today. In the future, you'll be gone. And then God will bring new people. Not everybody. I'm not saying you. That's just life sometimes, or flesh, or whatever. God called me. Yeah. He didn't call you. You just changed addresses. You're still doing the same old thing, and you're still unhappy. Don't fool yourself. Anyway, as we close, what does closing mean? Okay. Do you get the story today? That when you become more focused on what God can do than what man can do, then you'll learn to appreciate the woman or the man or the pastor. Wave your hand, Pastor Derek. Pastor Eddie, wave your hand. You'll learn to appreciate the leaders that God brings in your life without us having to have to worry about, did we mention this? Did we say that? Like, we're supposed to know everything about everybody. We're here to care for you, but to cause you to be fruitful and multiply. And if your focus is on you and you alone, you're going to go to heaven with you and you alone. But I want to be fruitful and multiply. I got to share with you a story. Well, let me give you this other verse here. Genesis. Oh, no, I don't have time. Nope. From Genesis 1 to Genesis 2. Hold off, guys. No. We'll just take that off. Thank you, though. Next week. Say next week. I'm going to share with you from Genesis 1 and 2 how God literally created this universe, including yourself, with words. With words. God created this world. In the beginning, God said, let there be light. In Genesis 2, he said it's not good for a man and woman to be alone. So he created marriage. I had this in my heart last night. The word from Michael earlier, I had this morning. But God gave me this word for last night. There are ladies believing for husbands. There are men believing for wives. And the Lord told me to tell you to speak it out. As God spoke it out in Genesis 2, you need to declare it and decree it according to the will of God. Now watch this. Oh, I got to close. Just a couple verses here. Proverbs 12, you're going to like this. You're going to appreciate that I gave you an extra couple minutes here. Proverbs 12, 13, 14. 12, 13, 14. The wicked is ensnared by the transgression of his lips. But the righteous will come through trouble. 14. A man will be satisfied by the fruit of his, scream the M word. That's what you just used, your mouth. Say it again. Go back to 13, please. The wicked are ensnared by the transgression of his what? Lips, words, mouth. But, verse 14, a man will be satisfied. How many want to be satisfied? Come on, I'm asking, how many want to be satisfied? I'm not a mind reader, I'm a word reader. How many want to be satisfied? Faith comes by hearing. How many want to be satisfied? A man will be satisfied with the good by the fruit of his mouth. Every day, my mouth creates fruit. Every day, I have the ability to create a lemon. Or I have the ability to speak lemonade. Every day, I can speak death and criticism and judgmentalism and condemnation. Or I can speak life and power. But a man who speaks the word, he will be fruitful and she will multiply. The other day, I looked at my vehicle. I love my black lac. I looked at it. I said, this thing's getting old, but I still like it. And I was looking through the years, all the scratches, you know, it just happens. Never once in an accident. Not once. Not even a ding. Not even a ding. Some scratches, you know, your car keys, this and that. So I like things right. And sometimes I do things that I should not do. Sometimes I should stick to my calling. So I went out and I bought a little spray paint. And I just wanted to touch up one of my doors. Well, how many know a little fox spoils the whole vine? Can you imagine what a big fox does? So I decided to spray the other door as well. It started with just a little nick. I start spraying. I didn't know, Mrs. McBerry, I didn't know the paint was going to start dripping and so forth. And I like excellence. I don't care how old the car is. I don't care how old you are. I like excellence. So I went, and I got estimates. I went through Carroll Stream there and St. Charles Road. That must be auto body, you know, from Mako to this one to that one. And I got estimates. Who said $1,330? Got to take off the Escalade thing, sign. Got to redo this, buff this, paint that. I received estimates from $1,330 to up to $6,000. Some said, just paint the whole thing. You don't want two doors looking. You don't want, and God bless these guys. So my estimates were from $1,330 to $6,000. But I went into one auto body shop. They were going to charge me close. I went to several. And they came up with almost $2,000. I said, I don't want to spend that money. So one of the gentlemen, he was nice. He had a ministry of excellence. He showed me around the body shop. Listen, I don't want to see the body shop. I just want to see my body get fixed. My car. So he gave me one word. Speak the word only. Hear this, guys. He gave me one word. Turpentine. Now, some of you are too young to remember the word turpentine. Some of you don't know what it means, turpentine. It used to be used as an oil to bring healing. But another word for turpentine, two words, is paint thinner. He said to me, one word, turpentine, paint thinner. He said, why don't you try some paint thinner? I went to an encounter. I got me that big gallon of paint thinner. I put that thing on my, Pastor Derek, I put that thing on my car. That old paint, that garbage paint, that spray came off. The original paint stayed on my car. Then I detailed it myself. I would drive it around to let you look at it today, but it looks brand spanking new, and I wasn't going to take it out in this weather. I've got my old Cadillac, 2003, 115,000 miles. Here's what I'm saying. One person I do not know from Adam gave me one word. One word. Today, it only takes one word for you to receive. You are one word away from a miracle. You're one word away from a breakthrough. You're just one word away from a breakthrough. Stand to your feet and give God praise. Give God a shout.
Don't sing, don't sing.
Give God praise. Give God praise. Listen to me. Listen to me. I want you to see, Trisha, I want you to see my car. It looks new. It's shiny. It's buff. Say it.
It's like a showroom. Showroom ready.
Sometimes we feel like it's over with. Sometimes we feel like I need something else. I need another man, another woman, another church, another job. Sometimes you're one word away from that which was scratchy, that which had dents, that which had scrapes. You're one word away. There's a miracle in your mouth. Speak the word only. This has been the word of the Lord.